So, you've heard of PokéRogue and you are a bit lost? Well, I'm here today to introduce you to this very addictive game. What is PokéRogue? It is a new take on the Pokémon roguelite and it's getting popular. The browser-based Pokémon fan game recently reached 100,000 accounts and it's getting more traction every day. Now, before we go into the explanation, I wanted to advertise my stream where I do my PokéRogue runs, twitch.tv/simplyiu_pokemon. Note that I don't only plan to stream PokéRogue, but also Emerald Rogue and my current Nuzlocke. The stream starts every day at 5:30 PM GMT. Now let's start with the different mods. The classic mod is a set of 200 floors with scripted battles along the way. You will have to fight against your rival, gym leaders and the Pokémon League. If you are interested in knowing which floor does what, you can go in my Twitch chat and type !! Rogue Battle. The reason I don't show them here is because those are spoilers. Whenever you beat a new gym leader, an E4 or champion, you get a voucher that you can use in the egg gacha. Then you have the Endless mod. As the name intends, there is an endless amount of floors that's getting harder and harder. In this mod, there is no trainer, no rival, no league, only wild Pokémon. The biome change every turn and you can find any Pokémon, Mega Transformation, Fusions, Legendaries, etc, etc. Defeating the boss on the 50, 100, 150 and 200th floor will give you an egg voucher plus every time. Defeating the special boss on the 250th floor gives you an egg voucher premium every time. This set of battles repeats endlessly for as long as you can continue. After that, you have the Daily Run. It is a pre-seeded set of 50 floors, so everyone has the same Pokémons, the same encounters, etc, etc. Then everyone fights to get the best score possible. If you win your Daily Run, you get a purple ticket for Egg Gacha, which is 10 pulls, and the Daily Run resets every day at 12 AM UTC. Finally, you have a mod called Fusion Run. There is a fusion mod that you can unlock by beating classic mod with a fusion Pokémon. It is basically endless, but with only fusion Pokémons. A note here, your starters will be randomly fused when you start your run. Let's move on to game menus. Before we go into a run, let's talk about those. Most menus are self-explanatory. Game settings allows you to modify the in-game settings, nothing mandatory here. To turn on or off, it is preference based. Note that if your browser lags after a fusion, you can turn the fusion palette swaps off to help. Achievement tracks your progress into the game. Achievement points do not do anything, at least for now. Stats are gonna track your stats. Vouchers is basically a list of all the vouchers that are available and the ones that you already have, and those can be gained by playing classic mode. After that, the egg list shows all the eggs that you have in your egg bag. Next up is gonna be egg gachas. Those are very important, so let's talk about rates and machines. Those are completely free to play. You earn those eggs by playing the game and only by playing the game. There are 5 tiers of egg: normal, rare, epic, legendary, and Manaphy. The egg gacha menu has 3 machines: Move Up, Legendary Up, and Shiny Up. Move Up machine helps you unlock egg moves. So hatched Pokémon also come with something called an egg move, and each Pokémon has 4 of them. 3 common moves and 1 rare move. It is possible to get a duplicate egg move when hatching a Pokémon you already have, and when you get a duplicate egg move, nothing is gained. The rarity of the egg dictates the chances of getting a rare egg move. So 1 in 48 for common, 1 in 24 for rare, 1 in 12 for epic, and 1 in 6 for legendary. Next up, we have the Legendary Up machine. It helps you get a legendary egg from 1 in 256 to 1 in 128. The featured legendary Pokémon changes every Sunday, and every legendary egg has a 50% chance to be the featured Pokémon. Finally, we have the Shiny Up machine. It helps you increase your chance at getting a shiny inside an egg from 1 in 128 to 1 in 64. Earlier, I said that there was 5 kinds of eggs. Let's talk about those rates. Common have a 79.7% to appear and hatch after 10 in-game floors. Rare or great have a 17.2% chance to appear and hatch after 25 in-game floors. Epic or Manaphy have a 2.7% chance to appear and hatch after 50 in-game floors. And finally, you have Legendary that has a 0.3% chance to appear and hatch after 100 in-game floors. Those eggs do not go into your team after hatching. They're gonna be available to you for your next run. The machine that you choose to invest in depends on what you are farming. If you are farming high-cost starters, you are better off choosing the Legendary Up machine. If you are farming shinies, go for the Shiny Up. And finally, if you are farming rare egg moves, go for the Move Up one. Finally, the next menus are Manage Data to export your session data, Community Links for the Discord, the Wiki, the GitHub, Return to Title Screen, and Logout of your account. Oof, okay, let's move on to a run. So first, starters. Some Pokémons have purple borders. Those Pokémons have what's called the Pokérus, meaning that they will earn extra EXP and that virus will, in time, spread to your team, meaning that all your Pokémons at some point are gonna earn extra EXP. Those three starters that have the Pokérus change every day at 12 a.m. UTC. Next, point distributions. In classic mode, you have 10 points to spend on Pokémons. If you pick 3 starters at 3 points, you have 9 points out of 10. In endless mode, you have 15 points to spend. So if you pick 3 starters at 3 points, you have 9 points out of 15. As you hatch or capture Pokémons, you will unlock more customization for each of them. You can cycle between shiny or not, natures, gender, and abilities. When you meet a Pokémon in the wild, you're going to notice that he has a Pokéball under his name. If the Pokéball is full, you have nothing to get from him except maybe better IVs. If the Pokéball is empty, you will get something from capturing it, a nature, an ability, or the opposite gender. Obviously, if there is no Pokéball, you do not have the Pokémon. After capturing or hatching the Pokémon, you will have a window that tells you what you got, new IVs, gender, ability, or nature. When you choose your starters, you need to keep in mind the egg moves as well. So when you hatch a Pokémon, you will unlock one or more egg moves that you can use for your next run, like I said earlier. For example, I got a Gligar in one of my eggs, and now I can start the run with Gligar for 4 points, but with Earthquake as one of its moves. Egg moves are extremely powerful and can completely carry your early game, so pay attention. You can select your egg moves by clicking on the Pokémon and rearrange your moves like that. Now earlier, I talked about point distribution. The Pokémon found in each egg tier depends on that Pokémon's base starter cost. So a Pokémon that costs 1 to 3 points can be found in common eggs. A 4 to 5 cost is a rare egg. 6 to 7 is an epic egg. And then finally 8 to 10 can be found in a legendary egg. So it is not possible to find an 8 cost in a common egg. It is always going to be based on the rarity. Manaphy eggs are very rare. And they are very special as well. They only contain Manaphy or Fion, and the chance to have a Manaphy is actually very low. It is 1 in 8. And then you have obviously 7 in 8 chance to find Fion. Next, you have something called cost reduction. It is possible to reduce the cost of every starters by catching or hatching enough of a species. Those numbers on the screen right now are the threshold for reducing the cost by 1 and 2. So, for example, if it says 25/100, it means that you need a total of 25 catches and hatches combined to reduce the cost by 1 point, and a total of 100 catches and hatches to reduce the cost by 2 points. Starters that cost 1 go down to 0.5 and then 0.25, and starters that cost 2 go down to 1 and then 0.5 respectively. For example, if I show you my cat right there, I have caught him 3 times and hatched him 2 times. it makes 5 in total, as you can see here. Since it is a cost 4 Pokémon, you need a combine of 10 to reduce the cost to 3, and a combine of 30 to reduce the cost to 2. Reducing the cost of your Pokémons is something that you're gonna do over time, but it is very well worth the time. Finally, during your time in-game, you will see some abilities with either a P or an N. P means that it's partially implemented. So move stats, BP, PP, accuracy or priority are implemented, but most of the time, additional effects are usually not. If they have a P. If there is no P or no N, it works as intended. Okay? And finally, N means not implemented, and those moves do nothing and should not be learned most of the time. Once you have your starters, it is now time to go in-game. So first, let's talk about biomes. A biome is an area of land that denotes the environment you are currently in. These biomes can change from one another in appearance, Pokémon, trainers, and even weather conditions. In classic mode, all biomes are 10 stages long, and your party is fully healed upon clearing the 10th consecutive stage of the current biome. In Endless, the biome changes every floor and you are still healed after the 10th stage. For example, let's say that you are starting in a grass biome, those are the Pokémon that you can encounter. So on this wiki page, you can see the encounter rarities. So for regular encounters, we have those odds, 69.5 for common, 24.2 for uncommon, 5% for rare, 0.98% for super rare, and 0.2% for ultra rare. Same for bosses, 68.8 for common, 21.9 for rare, 7.8 for super rare, and 1.6% for ultra rare. Keep in mind that you can capture all those Pokémons at any point and add them to your team. For bosses, you need to bring their health bar to 1, except if you have a Master Ball. Shinies can be encountered in the wild as well, and the chances are pretty high, it is 1 in 2000 chances. There is an item called the Shiny Charm that you can use to increase your odds from 1 in 2000 to 1 in 500. Those items can obviously stack, so you go from 1 to 2000 to 1 in 500, then 1 in 250 if you get another one. And if you capture an available starter, you can actually reuse it for your next runs. For example, my very first shiny in the wild was a Rattata, and so now I can actually use Rattata in my next runs. Once you reach the 10th stage of your current floor, you can travel to another biome. If you have a map, you can choose where to go, otherwise it is random. Biomes are connected, and there is the connection. In this case here, we were in a grass biome, so the only one we can travel to is gonna be tall grass. Then from the tall grass, we can go into the forest, etc., etc. You just have to follow the arrow. After each fight in the wild, you can switch your Pokémons around. A very important tip here is that you can keep your buff after each wild encounter, as long as you do not switch. For example, if you set up 6 Swords Dance on the first floor and you do not encounter any trainers, you can sweep the full floor with the same buff. It is a good thing for Endless mode, but it's still gonna reset every 10 floors. It is the same thing with hazards, so stuff like spikes, toxic spikes, and stealth rock, except they are not gonna last for 10 turns, they're gonna last for 5 turns. Keep in mind that in a trainer fight, all your buffs are reset and the mod is locked to set mod. Like I said during the mod explanation at the beginning, the big trainer fights are scripted, so feel free to check on the Pokérogue Discord or on my Twitch channel if you want to know in advance. At the end of each battle, you will have a line of items separated in two. You have the first line called the shop, where you can buy stuff to heal your Pokémons or restore your PPs. Then you have the second line where you have to choose one item among all of them. And those items have rarities. You have common at 75.1%, great at 18.5%, ultra at 4.69%, rogue at 1.12%, and finally master at 0.1. Those items have a chance to upgrade, to go from common to great or from great to ultra, and the upgrade chance can be increased by the number of shinies in your team. So the more shinies you have, the better loot you get at the end of each battle. These odds are as follows. If you have no shiny, it is 1 in 32 chances. If you have 1, it is 1 in 21. If you have 2, it is 1 in 16. If you have 3 of them, it is 1 in 12. Then 1 in 10, 1 in 9, and 1 in 8. Talking about the shop, you can choose to reroll your shop for money. And if you have a lock capsule, you can lock the rarities. I'm not going to list all the items in the game, but you have a list available on the wiki. You can find Pokeballs, vitamins, candies, berries, X items with a limited duration, type boosting items, DNA splicer. Keep in mind that Gigantamax forms, Mega Evolutions, and Fusions are permanent in this game, and that item stacks. You can stack vitamins, you can stack berries, EXP items, X items, etc., etc. If at any point you are lost and you don't know what item does what, you can hover with your mouse on one of your items or the enemies to know what it does. One tip for you here is that money and EXP are very important. So do not skip items like nuggets, candies, lures, for other unimportant stuff like Pokeballs, for example. I repeat, prioritize EXP and money if you can. Pick up lures, do not be afraid of double battles. There are some Pokemons with the pickup ability and some moves like Covet or Thief that are pretty strong to get as starters because any items that you find or steal are permanent. Which is why Pokemons like Zigzagoon or the Cat can be considered good. Those items that you steal can then be transferred during the shopping phase. It is free and do not skip the phase 2. Now, let's talk about evolutions. So not all the evolutions in this game are one-to-one with the mainland game. You can find all the details on the wiki. A Pokémon like Haunter evolves into a Gengar with a trade. But in PokéRogue, you will have to find what's called a linking cord. This card can be found after a battle and it is a rogue rarity item. A Pokemon like Gimmighoul evolves into Goldengo with 999 Gimmighoul coins, but in PokéRogue, you will have to increase your friendship score to 70, starting at 50. A Pokemon like Eevee can evolve into any of its forms, but you will have to find the corresponding stone during the looting phase after a battle. You get the point, right? Most evolutions have been changed to fit the game, but some evolutions like the Eevee ones are very RNG based. Happiness as well has been tweaked. I talked about Gimmighoul earlier. To get from 50 to 70, you will have to do one of those things. So participate in a battle is +2 friendship, rare candies is +5, and fainting is -10. And of course, you have some items like the Soothe Bell, that exists, it multiplies the bonus per stack by 1.5. Now to finish on this video, since we are talking about evolution, let's talk about Fusion, Mega, and G-Max. To fusion two Pokémons, you need what's called a DNA splicer. It is a very rare item. It is a Master Ball rarity tier item, and this is how it works. The base stats of the two Pokémon are averaged. The moves, learn set, and items are combined. IVs and nature come from the first Pokémon. The first type comes from the first one. The second or only type comes from the second. The ability comes from the second. And the second Pokémon used cannot be recovered if you decide to unsplice later on. So when it comes to fusion, I would say most of the time it is not worth doing early on because the stats that are average are pretty bad. But later on, if you have two pretty big Pokemons and there is a reason to do some fusions, you can go for it. And there is a fusion mod that you can unlock at some point as well where you can do some experiments. It is actually a pretty fun mod to use. Now, the sprite of the Pokémon won't change. So if you choose Bulbasaur first and then Pikachu, you're going to have a Bulbasaur with the color of a Pikachu. And of course, you have a fusion of the two names. So some of them can be funny. There is some example here, but name-wise, it can be pretty interesting. Now, to allow for Mega Transformation, you need a Rogue Rarity item called the Mega Bracelet. Once you have this item, if you have a Pokémon that can Mega Evolve, you will have a chance to get the item that allows it, and those evolutions are permanent. Finally, for the G-Max form, it is the same. You need an item called the Dynamax Band to unlock them. You cannot Dynamax all the Pokémon, just a few. There is actually a list on the wiki. Again, you just have to find them on there. When you have the Dynamax Band, if you have a Pokémon that can have a G-Max form, again, found on the wiki, you will have a chance to find what's called a Max Mushroom. And those are, like the Mega Evolution, permanent. And that's gonna be it for this video on PokéRogue. I hope you are enjoying the game so far. If you want to find a list of all the different changes, you have a changelog channel on the PokéRogue Discord. Or, of course, you can access their GitHub and Trello page if you want to learn more about the different features that are coming in the game. The game is still a work in progress. Some moves don't work, of course, but it is gonna be better in the future for sure. Thank you guys for watching. And do not forget to join me on Twitch if you can, that would be nice. Tell me that you like the video or dislike the video, tell me why. And I will see you all in the next one. Bye!